Some of us feel that our wisdom can fetch us whatever we want in this world. And then others are a kind of Christians who feel that whoever does not perform miracle is not of God. Whoever does not perform wonders is not God. But this kind of people try to send away their attention from God and then tries to see that God is the kind of a miraculous God, or with your wisdom one can build faith. No, what God wants is our attention on Him. But then, in the first reading, God calls us to a basic condition, a basic standard of living that will confirm us as children of God. Now, from the book of Exodus chapter 20, now we are presented with the Decalogue. Now, there were a lot of laws that were manifested within this time. But now God came with a covenant. The Ten Commandments stand as a covenant, an instruction, or a basic condition which God has given Moses for the people of God, for His people. These are conditions, these are standards that when we keep them, we make ourselves strong children of God and enjoy the benefits of the children of God. The difference between these laws and the other laws that were manifested, that were existent within that time, was that other laws of the pagans were a kind of laws that if you don't do this, you will be punished. If you don't do this, you will be killed. But the difference between these laws and the Ten Commandments is that God has given us an instruction. He has given us an address of Himself. Do not call the name of God in vain. Do not be of this attitude. Honor your father and your mother. Thou shalt not kill. Thou shalt not steal. These are negative or bad, odd attitudes that make all of us not children of God. But in this covenant, God is calling us to put away these attitudes that will make us less children of God. But these standards, they are the standard that when we keep them, then we become good Christians. We are very opportune that in this season of Lent, and at this third week of Lent, the church is giving us the opportunity, calling our attentions to this standard of living. This standard of living will make us not take our minds away from God. But when we become faithful to this standard of living, then we remain children of God. But why? In the gospel reading, we'll be seeing the fulfillment of this standard of living. We'll be seeing Christ bringing this standard of living as a new way of living. Now, in the second reading, from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians, chapter 1. Now, St. Paul tries to summarize his preaching on the crucified Christ. But then, the people had this intention or had this mindset of putting their minds on what their efforts can do for them. For the Greeks tried to see wisdom as fetching them whatever they want. The Jews also tried to see that whatever is not miraculous, whatever is not of wonder, signs and wonders, then that is not their, it is not their concern. Then it is not God. So they see God as that miraculous Messiah. They see God as that Messiah who performs signs and wonders. Forgetting, St. Paul tries to say, what I preach is the crucified Christ. The crucified Christ was obedient to this standard of living. He was obedient even unto death, and it fetched him the right hand of God. And so this Christ has given us a standard. He has come to show us that this standard, when we keep them, we become good and strong children of God. So St. Paul was like, when we keep this standard of living, then we become Christians. But now when we drift, when we go away from this standard of living, we then become less children of God. We cut ourselves away from becoming children of God. But then in the gospel reading, from the gospel of John chapter 2, now Christ tries to cleanse the temple. The temple was now used, instead of worship to God, the temple was used for some criminal things, for some other different things than the worship of God. And what was that? The temple was used as marketplace. Now, this temple, instead of being the temple of God, the temple where the people worship and thank God, now these people tried to use this temple as a place of market. But there was something that was existent within that time. It was the time of Easter. And so within this time, people from different places come to Jerusalem to celebrate this Passover, this Easter. And so when they come, when they come to Jerusalem, now instead of being their attentions channeled to what was supposed to be, or the right thing, that is the worship of God. Now these people try to buy and sell. And so now in the temple, they now overturn the temple for buying and selling, for marketing. And so Christ now, we are not sure of how he felt, but then we can understand his feeling that the temple was not to be used for marketing. And so he condemned that attitude of using the temple for market purposes. And so Christ tries to cleanse the temple of these things that will make one not become children of God. And so he has come to solidify these our standards. He now cleans the temples of the old ways and tries to introduce a new way. This new way is the way of the Lord. This new way is the way of the crucified Christ. This new way is the way that leads to peace, the way that leads to life. And so he said, destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will build this temple. And so the Jews were like thinking it was this physical temple, but then Christ meant his body, the church. Now when we destroy this temple by our false life, by sin, by not doing what God wants us to do, God is calling us at this season of Easter. He is calling us that he is ready to cleanse us. He is ready to build us. That is ready to build us at Easter. He is ready to make us new and green again. And so he expects us to be of good behavior. He expects us to be Christ-like. He expects us to be Christians. He expects us to use these commandments so well that when we use these basic conditions, this basic standard of living as children of God, then He, Christ, will not bring us together and then recreate us, renew us, and bring us into new life. And so, dear friends, may the good Lord continue to bless our efforts, that as we make efforts to journey with Christ in this Lent, that we'll journey with Christ, and then at Easter we'll resurrect with Christ. And when we resurrect with Christ, all things will go well for us as Christians who believe and are faithful to the works of the Holy Spirit, are faithful to our doings, to our actions, to our behaviors as Christians. Remember, we should not at this season of Lent diversify our attentions to the wrong thing. Let us bring our minds together. Let us in conscience, let us now become Christ-like so as to resurrect and be recreated at Easter. May the good Lord bless you.